is Helen Albert. I'm a freelance science journalist, and I'm here today with Stephanie Tylenius, who is the CEO and founder of Vida Health. Hi, Stephanie. I wonder if, to start off with, you could walk us through Vida's business model and how your business is driving better health outcomes for consumers.
Absolutely. Great to be here today. Vida Health is a virtual care provider for physical and mental health. And we bundle everything in one place to make it really easy for consumers to manage their chronic conditions and both physical and mental health conditions. So we cover everything from weight loss to obesity to diabetes to depression, anxiety, etc. And we bundle devices. We provide a real-time monitoring service. We have digital therapeutic programs and interventions. And really importantly, we have the human connection. So we bring a network of providers across 50 states, and we're really providing the real-time care that people need to manage their chronic disease.
Okay, thank you. So can you give me a bit of a scale for the business? I mean, the sort of revenue, customers, et cetera, and the sort of growth in these metrics?
Well, as you know, COVID is an accelerant for a lot of digital health these days. So we have tripled consultations in the last 3 months, and the business is growing like crazy. We have over 1.5 million covered lives, and we now have 800 providers in 50 states. So we're scaling. We're really helping people in this time of need, where there's greater need for serving individuals who have chronic disease and are afraid of getting COVID, and then folks who are suffering from mental health conditions related to being, you know, at home or worrying about their loved ones or their jobs. So seeing a lot of increase in growth in mental health conditions, stress, depression, anxiety, depression, those kinds of conditions.
Okay. So I understand your last fundraising was for 25 million at the end of April. I just wondered if you could comment a bit on this, on whether you are happy with this amount or whether you are hoping for more, for example, given your competitor Lyra's recent impressive raise of over 100 million, I think.
Well, that's a good question. It's, you know, it's funny. It's not a contest for necessarily how much capital you raise. It's much more about how you use that capital and how efficient you are with the capital. And so we're really happy with the scale that we've achieved with the capital we've raised. And it's mostly because we've taken a platform approach. And we've really been able to look at meeting people where they're at and solving their chronic disease, combining both physical and mental health. So someone comes in, and if they have, there's someone with diabetes and depression, we're able to give them a really personalized approach. So I think our platform approach is really helping us scale.
Okay. So I just wondered, do you think there's maybe timing or something to do with this? Because I know they, for example, Lyra did their raise very recently. And obviously the impact of COVID has meant that lots of there's been a lot of interest in the sector from an investment point of view as well. So do you think, do you have any further plans to try and capitalize on this at all? Or
there is a lot of investor interest in this space, as you've seen with COVID. It's accelerated virtual care across the board, and now they're saying virtual care will be $100 billion business by 2025. And so we've seen a lot of interest in our company. So we'll see how that progresses. But definitely, we're scaling, growing, and there's a ton of interest to partner and invest.
Okay. So you have an impressive background in the tech industry, having worked with, you know, big players such as Google and eBay, but Vida, I believe, is your first health venture. I just wondered if you could comment a bit on what your motivation was on setting up the company and how you found it since then, and maybe what your biggest learning experience has been as a CEO.
Well, I started the company because my father had multiple chronic conditions. So I have a background in scaling platforms to millions of consumers at eBay and Google, and very used to building really high-end consumer products that solve key pain points and have high NPS scores and really deliver. And I was looking at my father had diabetes, hypertension, CHF, COPD, and depression. And he had multiple doctors, he had different medications, and no one was really giving him the day-to-day guidance that he needed. And I really wanted to see his vitals on a day-to-day basis. I wanted like remote patient monitoring effectively. I wanted coaching for him, accountability, advice on his medication adherence, changes that he might should be making to his meds, all these things, and it didn't exist. There was really, it was just fascinating. There was no Amazon or Google or eBay equivalent in healthcare. And I thought, how can this be? It's 20% of GDP. So I just started prototyping and trying to solve that personal problem. And then it became, I realized that all the skills that I have from having worked in technology and scaling consumer product experience to millions of users could be applied to healthcare and could really have a big impact on people's lives. And what better way to spend your time helping other people? So I got further into the chronic care problem and decided this was really warranting building a company. And so that's how Vida came to be. And I would say, you know, when I look back upon the lessons, you know, in my background, I've built really strong products. So for example, there's something called the toothbrush test. So when I was at Google, Larry had this expression that you always want to build products that are like toothbrushes. You use them, you know, twice a day, and people use Google multiple times a day. So I feel really proud that we've created something that has, we have a 75 NPS, we have a great product platform. We pass the toothbrush test for some of our chronic patients. I mean, the majority of our patients are using us every day. And so that's wonderful. We're really having, we have strong clinical outcomes. We're having a great impact. I think the big learning has been that to scale in healthcare at the level that I'm used to in tech takes a lot longer. It moves at a glacial pace. And part of that is because of the payment model, right? So to get things right in healthcare, it's all about reimbursement. It's all about payment model. Even with all those things, if you look at us and you look at all the digital health players combined, we're touching not even a million users. And there's 147 million people in the United States alone that have chronic disease. So it's still in its infancy. There's a long way to go. And I wish it were moving faster than it is, because I think this is really important and having a big impact on people's lives.
Mm. You mentioned the payment model. I think that's actually was a question I wanted to ask about, because I wondered how you'd approach costing the service, and because I think I understand correctly, you've gone down both the individual and the health plan or employer approach, and I wondered why you decided to do that and what's been most successful from a business point of view.
Well, so health plans and employers pay for health in the United States for the majority of, besides Medicare and Medicaid, most people get their insurance to cover their health spend. And so if you're a person living with diabetes, you expect it to be covered by your health plan. So we sell to large insurance companies, we sell to large employers, and we really try to make sure we focus on the end consumer experience, and that's why we get strong outcomes. But we also focus on how we actually are reducing costs for our buyers, which are the large insurance companies and the employers. And all of our expenses can be billed through claims, and so it factors into the payment model the way healthcare does today. So it makes it easy for them to expense it.
But I think you also you can also buy the app as an individual consumer, right?
You can. And the reason we do that is, well, first of all, we wanted to have a way for, I mean, there are consumers who will pay out of pocket. Consumers particularly will pay for weight loss and therapy out of pocket. For diabetes, hypertension, and some of the more chronic, asthma, COPD, other chronic conditions, they tend to believe that it should be covered by their insurance plan.
But I mean, I think in digital health in general, that's an interesting topic, and it's a sort of a tricky one. And I mean, did you keep that window open just so people have that option? I mean, it sounds like most of your consumer.
Most of our business is, I think most of the business growth you're seeing in digital health is all B2B for the most part. Because people expect that their insurance cover, you know, their insurance should cover it. And more services are being covered by, you know, HSAs and preventive care as well, included in high deductible health plans.
So I think I want to go back to what you were saying about one of your sort of USPs is the fact that you're tracking multiple conditions at the same time. So I just wondered, how do you ensure quality and medically sound advice to your customers? For example, how do you recruit your coaches and ensure they're giving out good advice?
So we recruit only folks who've had a minimum of 5 years experience, who are trained in certain areas. We, for example, on the therapy side, we'll look for CBT training. For RDs, they're licensed and they have multiple years of practice. And then we build our own digital therapeutic programs that are evidence-based. And we have strong clinical outcomes, and we work to publish all these outcomes. And so we track everything. We track, individuals and how they're performing along the way. We have daily data from them. And we know if they're going to hit their A1C reduction, we know if they're going to hit their hypertension reduction goals, weight loss goals, PHQ, GAD, all these different metrics. And we report that back. And the providers are also, like some of their, we're working back with PCPs as well, who are looking at this data. So we take a very clinical, evidence-based approach, and we make sure that the interventions are driving the outcomes.
Yeah. So, but for example, say, have you got a built-in sort of fail-safe? So if a customer, some of these problems are quite big problems. So if, say, a coach is online with someone and they, they're really sick, is there some kind of way?
We do. We have a 24/7 response system. So there is a hotline, and we can refer people to, like, if there's a massive issue. I mean, the coaches can handle it, but if there's like a suicide issue or something else, we get them to the place that they need to care immediately. And we're tracking outcomes and day-to-day interventions, so we can see if somebody's off track, and if they're not being successful, we can intervene.
So do you work with the sort of medics for this, or how does that work?
What do you mean by medics?
So like the doctors?
Yeah, we have doctors on our team, and we have clinicians across our organization in every functional area. So we have experts in, endocrinology for diabetes. We have experts in psychiatry for mental health disorders, et cetera. So we have expert SMEs, we call them experts in each of the areas, and they're MDs all the way to coaches, nurses, therapists, et cetera.
Okay. So I wanted to go back to this space. Like, I know you said when you set up the company that there was not very many other options in this area. I know that there are now a number of digital health options, and there's becoming more day by day. And I just wondered what you're doing to stay ahead of the competition, and what you think about whether the interest of big players like Google, Amazon, and Apple, for example, do they make it easier or harder for smaller companies like yourselves to succeed?
I think that the fact that there's a lot of competition means that this space is ripe for change, and you're going to see in the next decade a real transformation in healthcare. So we're excited by all the movement. We continue to innovate and drive a great product experience. We have a high NPS, great product, great outcomes. I think Apple, Google, Amazon is all a good thing in many ways. I mean, frankly, we all need to band together to change 20% of GDP in this country and make it better for everyone. So. And they're all doing, the tech companies are all doing different things. So they're playing to their individual strengths. So Apple's playing to, I have my Apple Watch on, so they're playing to the device strength and tracking. I hope they do CGM. I don't know if that's in their plans, but they're doing, they're tracking your heart rate and hopefully glucose and other things. And then Amazon's looking at distribution of prescription meds, which makes sense given their logistics experience. They just launched Halo device to track, and that makes sense given their Alexa distribution. And then, of course, Google's looking at all the data and partnering on the Google Cloud side and trying to look at how we create interoperability. They're looking at a big study with Baseline. So they're each doing these big plays that really map to their individual DNA, and I think it helps move the industry forward.
Okay. I just wondered, you mentioned that you've got, you're collecting a lot of stats, and I wondered what you're doing to prove cost effectiveness. Could you comment on that a bit about, what you're collecting and how it's proving the efficacy of your service?
So we capture all sorts of data. We capture device data, claims data, Rx data, blood work, and then we track users on their progression. And we measure clinical savings, medical cost savings with claims data, medical data. We look at Rx spend. We look at reduction in ER or hospital admissions. We're constantly looking at what are the PM savings that we're driving from our service.
And have you shown that you are definitely driving savings?
Yes, we have clear medical cost savings. And we cover a broad spectrum, so we'll handle people. Like, we have a CDC, DPP program that's for prediabetes, and we have weight loss where we show a 7 to 10% reduction in weight loss. But then we also handle people with diabetes who may have diabetes, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, and we're showing a reduction of over a point of A1C, and 76% reduction in hypertension, and then overall medical cost savings. So we cover a broad range of acuity. And we have medical cost savings along the way. Obviously, the cost savings for individuals who are higher cost in the system and have multiple chronic diseases higher than someone who is just pre-diabetic.
So I wondered, something I was sort of thinking about with your service, because you mentioned that one of your motivations to start was your father and with him. And I know a lot of the times, you know, chronic conditions tend to accumulate as we get older. And I mean, I know it's not necessarily always the case, but I know sometimes a lot of older people are often less familiar with this kind of tech. And I wondered how you found that and whether you've found that the older generation are taking up the tech just as well as the younger generation, or if you've got any comments about that.
Yeah, it's a great question. I mean, I will say that I was equally skeptical when we first started working with Medicare. I had the same question, but I've been blown away by the engagement. So, you know, everyone is capable of texting these days, and everyone wants a human connection. And so we're seeing 15 app opens a week. We're seeing 77% sending a message to their coach in a week. They're engaging in lessons. They're engaging. They're using their devices. So we're pretty blown away by the Medicare engagement. And it's really important because that's one of the parts of the population that need it most.
So what's your, I mean, what's the most common demographic for your, and of your users, if you are you able to share that?
Well, we cover 18 to 82, I think, or 83. We've had, we cover a broad range because we are rolled out with employers and payers. Mm-hmm. So we don't. But I think what you typically would see in the United States is there's 147 million people living with chronic disease. 40% of those have two or more. The average individual at Vida that we're serving has 3.3 chronic disease. You know, so they have multiple conditions. So our sweet spot is really handling people who are, you know, have are living with at least one, if not more, chronic diseases.
And do they tend to be a bit older? Or?
I don't know the average age. It's a good question. I mean, we do have Medicare customers, and we also have self-insured employers, and those averages are much lower.
Okay. So of course, at the moment, we couldn't really have a talk like this without mentioning the COVID-19 pandemic. So I wonder if, you know, do you think the increased interest in the virtual services such as those offered by yourselves will continue for years to come, or do you think it will die down by the time we get to next year?
You know, I would say the silver lining for COVID has been the acceleration of virtual care and people realizing how valuable it can be, especially given the number of people that have chronic disease in our country that are at risk, higher risk for COVID. And then when you look at mental health, what's been really surprising and I think really important is that COVID has accelerated this notion of dealing with it, facing up to the cost, the stigma, the access issues related to mental health. And now everyone, you know, employers and payers, everyone's saying we really have to take this head on. And so it's been an accelerant. And then now everyone's talking about how big the virtual care business is going to be. And you know, I think something like 69% of visits in May were virtual, and it's gone back down in July. And I think it'll go back down from the height in COVID, but I don't think we're going back to where it was. I mean, prior to COVID, I think it was single digits. So I don't think we're going back, and people have realized the value and how much more convenient and easier it is to use.
So obviously it's been a lot of change within a fairly short period of time. I'm wondering how are you planning for this, or how have you planned for this at the company, and you know, how are you trying to make the most of this situation?
Well, we're always, I mean, we're a startup, and we're a mid-stage startup, and we focus on growth, right? So our whole DNA is about tackling these kinds of things and growing fast. And so we're set up with all these metrics and, you know, the sort of DNA to handle fast growth. So it's been great, actually.
That can come up.
And you know, personally, just being able to give back during this time and focus on something that helps other people, it makes it easier to go through a global pandemic and, you know, fires in California and all these crazy things going on. So.
Yeah, definitely. So I think for the final part of this conversation, I just wanted to go for the underrated, overrated competition. So this is, again, I'll share with you a few terms, and you tell me whether you think they're overrated or underrated.
Okay.
Just bear with me a second. Okay, Okay, so to start with, I will go for virtual coaching.
Virtual coaching, I think, is underrated in the sense that I think if you look at the spend in our country on chronic disease, it's about $1.2 trillion if you break down diabetes, depression, musculoskeletal, all the conditions. And much of that is reactive and a prescriptive reactive kind of solution. And I think we should be looking at it in a continuous care upfront preventive approach. So I think there's going to be a massive growth for coaching and therapy and taking some of the burden off physicians and letting physicians practice at the top of their license and having other individuals manage individuals with chronic disease on a day-to-day continuous basis that gets better outcomes.
Okay.
Yeah, I think we overrate the value of an in-person primary care visit. I mean, there's so much data that we can get day-to-day from an individual with remote patient monitoring. It's so much more efficient. You don't have to drive to see someone, and it expands access. So I'm excited about leveraging, you know, all these experts in our healthcare system beyond just the primary care doctor.
Okay. So the next term I'd like to suggest is mindfulness.
Mindfulness, that's a tough one. In some ways, I would say it's underrated, especially, you know, in our time right now and how much we need to be mindful and grateful. We're also stressed, so it helps. But on the other hand, I feel like it's overrated because some people are thinking that mindfulness is a solve, you know, for depression and anxiety, but you actually really need real interventions for those. So a lot of the mindfulness apps have been, I think, exaggerated in terms of their clinical efficacy or the perceived clinical efficacy of mindfulness.
Okay. So finally, how about AI in medicine?
That's underrated. I think there's so much opportunity when you look at interoperability that we will get to and all the data sharing that will occur. You can imagine every vertical of medicine transformed by having access to patient data and looking at using AI for symptom checking and radiology and cancer mapping, and it's endless. I think it's underrated.
Mm. Do you use AI yourselves?
We do use AI. We have AI and machine learning throughout our product.
Mm.
And the comparison of individuals and looking at individuals with chronic disease and their patterns is really important, and then using what we call VidaBot in our app to send messages and converse is really important as well. So, and I think that we don't want to take the human out of the equation, but we are using machine learning and AI to empower our providers to do more and to simplify the experience.
Okay, well, thank you very much for your time, Stephanie. That was great.
Thank you.